Mr. Hiram Otis, the American minister, was in England with his family, which includes Washington, who is an aristocratic young man, Mrs. Otis, his wife, Virginia, his only daughter, and the twins, who are always causing mischief. While scoring out neighborhoods for a proper house, he stumbled upon a lovely looking mansion, the Canterville Chase. Despite having been rumored to house a ghost, he is very enthusiastic about buying the mansion. He receives many warnings, even from Lord Canterville. Mr. Hiram Otis and Lord Canterville conversing.
Oh, Mr. Canterville, what a lovely mansion. What made you stay away from the chase?
Since my grand aunt, Dowager Duchess of Bolton, was frightened into a fit from which she never recovered, I feel bound to tell you, the chase is haunted by a ghost.
My lord, I will take the furniture and the ghost at valuation. I don't believe in these paranormal beings. I am a modern American man.
Mr. Otis then continues on to seal the deal. The Otis family moves over to the Canterville Chase during the next evening. On entering the house, he is greeted by the house caretaker, Mrs. Umne.
I bid you welcome to the Canterville Chase. I am afraid something has been spilt there.
It is the blood of Lady Eleanor de Canterville, who was murdered on that very spot by her own husband, Sir Simon Canterville, in 1575.
What utter nonsense! Pinkerton's champagne stain remover and paragon detergent will clean it up in no time.
Hiram, what can we do with the woman who faints?
Charge it to her like breakages. She won't faint after that.
The next day, when Mrs. Umne regains consciousness, she confronts Mr. Otis about her fears and their cavalier attitude towards the ghost.
I have seen things with my own eyes, sir.
My dear lady, we are not afraid of ghosts.
The evening progresses smoothly after that, although with the bad weather dampening the mood. The next day, Washington comes into the living room to find the bloodstain, even though he had just cleaned it the day before.
It's not the paragon detergent's fault, but the ghost.
A few days later, a few hours into the night, Mr. Otis wakes up on hearing some strange noises, similar to clanking chains outside his bedroom.
What is that noise?
My dear sir, I have brought you a bottle of Tammany Rising Sun Lubricator to oil your chains.
Thank you. next day, as they were having lunch, Mr. Otis remembers the events of the past day.
Considering the length of time the ghost has spent in the house, I don't think it's at all polite to throw pillows at him.
It would be quite impossible to sleep with such a noise going on outside the bedrooms.
If he really declines to use the rising sun lubricator, we shall have to confiscate his chains.
For the rest of the week, the family was undisturbed, the only sign of the ghost being the constant renewal of the bloodstain. The changing colors of the bloodstain was a topic that was greatly discussed. Sometimes it was a dull red, then vermilion, sometimes a rich purple. One day it even turned emerald green. The ghost reappeared only on the next Sunday, this time prepared to scare the wits out of Mrs. Otis.
If it is indigestion, you will find it a most excellent remedy.
The ghost, angry, upset, confused and sad with the treatment and abuse of him from Otis' family, turns to head to his haunt when he is ambushed by another ghost.
Hey Otis ghost, ye only true and original spook. Beware of ye imitations, all others are counterfeit.
When the ghost finds these words written near the model of the ghost, he is infuriated. So he takes an oath to wreak havoc onto the twins.
When Chandelier had sounded twice his merry horn, deeds of blood would be fraught, and murder walk abroad with silent feet.
The ghost is infuriated when the cock does not crow the second time. The ghost prepares to scare the twins. When he goes to their room, a bucket full of water falls on him. After that incident, the ghost gave up any hope he had left of scaring the Otis family and did not appear anywhere again. One day, when Virginia was walking along a corridor, she noticed someone in a room and went in. It was the Canterville ghost himself.
I'm so sorry for you, but my brothers are going back to Eton tomorrow, and then, if you behave yourself, no one will annoy you.
It was absurd asking me to behave myself. My only reason for existing is rattling my chains and groaning through the keyholes.
It is no reason at all for existing. And you know, you have been very wicked. You'd killed your own wife. It is very wrong to kill anyone.
I killed my wife because she was not at all good at doing household works and terrible in cooking. So I killed her. Because I killed her, her brothers made me starve to death. I have not eaten anything since I have been a ghost. I have to say that you are much nicer than rest of your rude, dishonest
it's
family.
It's not my family who've been rude and dishonest. It was you who was rude. Also, you stole all my color paints to renew your bloodstains. Now, I'm left with only blue and white color, with which I cannot make much of painting. I don't want to talk to you. I'm going. I'll give you a suggestion to go to America, as you would be a source of entertainment for people there.
Please, don't go. You know, I've not slept for last 300 years.
Why have you not slept? You don't have any place to sleep?
I wish to sleep in the garden of death, the churchyard. And it is only possible if someone weeps for me and prays for me. Only then the angel of death will be merciful on me. It's only you who can make the doors of death house open for me, as you are full of love, and love is greater than death.
The ghost and Virginia moved towards the library where the old prophecy on the window said, when a golden girl can win prayers from out of the lips of sin, when the barren almond bears and a little child give away its tears, then shall all the house be still and peace come to Canterville.
I don't know what that means.
It means that you must weep with me for my sins because I have no tears, and pray with me for my soul because I have no faith. And if you have always been sweet and good and gentle, then the angel of death will have mercy on me. There will be worldly voices in the darkness to distract you, but they will not harm you. For against the purity of a little child, the powers of hell cannot prevail.
Go back.
Quick,
go
back. Quick, make it go fast, back. Or it will be too late.
Go back, go back, go back, go back, go back.
It was around dinner time when people finally noticed Virginia's disappearance.
It's tea time and Virginia is not yet down. She might have gone to fetch flowers in the garden.
The watch hands moved fast and it was time for dinner. But Virginia was missing and it alarmed everybody. Servants searched for her everywhere, but to no avail.
Dear, I am very afraid. Virginia has not yet come home. Please go and find her.
Mr. Otis, along with servants and Duke of Cheshire, went on to search for her. They searched for her in near villages, asked the station master, but could not find her.
What happened? Did you find her? Where's my daughter?
We could not find her. Now everyone, please go to sleep. Tomorrow, we will inform of her disappearance to Scotland Yard. They'll most definitely find her.
As it was midnight, everyone was about to leave the dining room. The clock struck midnight, and when the last stroke sounded, they heard a crash and a sudden shrill cry. There was thundering all around. A secret door opened. Virginia appeared.
Good heavens, my dear child. Where have you been?
I was with the ghost, and now he is dead. You must come and see him. He had been very wicked, but he was really sorry for all that he had done. And he gave me this box of beautiful jewels before he died.
Virginia led the family to a secret chamber via narrow passage. There they found the skeleton of the Canterville Ghost.
God has forgiven him.
4 days after the incident, the funeral procession started from Canterville Chase. In the corner of the graveyard, Sir Simon's remains were buried. A few days after the funeral, Mr. Otis and Lord Canterville meet.
My lord, I know that in this country, mortmain is held to apply to trinkets as well as to land, and it's quite clear that these jewels belong to your family. As my daughter is very young, and I don't want her to indulge in such luxuries, my wife had told me that these jewels are of great value. But considering the British aristocracy, I would like you to have these jewels.
My dear sir, your charming little daughter rendered my unlucky ancestor a very important service. and my family will be in debt to you always. Coming on jewels, they clearly belong to your daughter, for it was handed to her by my ancestor. And also to note that you bought the chase from me, and according to any legal agreement, anything related to the chase will belong to you. Moreover, when Virginia grows up, I dare say she will be pleased to have pretty things to wear.
Mr. Otis could not refuse to Lord Canterville and had to accept the jewels. Virginia afterwards married the Duke of Cheshire and they lived happily ever after.
Hey you boys! Get out of there boys! Get out of that house! Don't you know that house is haunted? There's an old deserted mansion on an old forgotten road, where the better ghosts and goblins always hang out. One night they threw a party in a manor a la mode, and they cordially invited all the gang out. At a dark, bewitching hour, when the fun was loud and hearty, a notorious wallflower became the life of the party. Where the spooks were having their midnight fling, the merrymaking was in full swing. They shrank themselves into a cheerful trance when skeleton in the closet started to dance. Now a goblin giggled with fiendish glee, and a shout rang out from a big banshee. Amazement was in every ghostly glance when the skeleton in the closet started to dance. All the witches were in stitches, while their steps made rhythmic thumps. And when they dropped the broomstick, when it tried to do the bumps, you never heard such earthy laughter, such hilarious groan, when the skeleton in the closet rattled his groan. Stitches while his steps made rhythmic thumps, and then nearly dropped the broomsticks when he tried to do the bumps. You never heard such early laughter, such hilarious groan when the skeleton